Hello, everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. Southwest Atlanta residents had a chance to voice their concerns about public safety. City officials and the council members who represent that area put on their listening ears. This public safety meeting wrapped up a series of town hall forums held in Southeast and Southwest Atlanta to address the city's commitment to reduce crime. The large crowd at the Adamsville Recreation Center heard directly from Mayor Kasim Reed about his plans to protect this city.
But as I stand here tonight, we've actually hired 800 police officers, and we've stood up the largest police force in the history of the city of Atlanta. And we've done something else. Chief Cochran is here. And Chief Cochran has also stood up the largest fire department, fire and rescue department, in more than 15 years. And that doesn't sound like a big deal unless you got a fire at your house. So what that means is our fire trucks now have 4 individuals on them, and we have eliminated brownouts and blackouts and hired 75 additional new firefighters in the city of Atlanta.
Constituents in that area are concerned about car theft, gang activity, break-ins, and youth crime.
I've been working with young people for 20 years, and I'm concerned about the growing violence that's taking place in our community, our homes, our schools.
This summer, we had 2,900 kids in Camp Best Friends. You might be saying, what does that have to do with the public safety? I'll tell you what it has to do. Teen crime is down more than 14% because our kids have organized activities to go to 6 days a week.
Police Chief George Turner mentioned that new technology will help track crime. APD even has new equipment in the police cruisers.
Talking about our fleet, what happens with that fleet under this administration? We've been able to add some technology in our cars to be able to see exactly where officers have gone and the speed that they go into the neighborhood. And so what it gives us an opportunity to do is have our sergeants to look at the patrol patterns of the officers and then direct them on how and where they need to be. When I talk about a threat pole and I talk about the small geographical area on where we predict that crime to be, we use that system to be able to determine where officers have been. So now when you say that you hadn't seen a police car on your beat, I can then go back and look at the history of that car and find out where he spent his time.
The city is diligently working to improve Southwest Atlanta and Martin Luther King Jr. Drive.
And our goal is to make Martin Luther King and this corridor the most attractive Martin Luther King in the United States of America. Because everybody here knows that if you want to find a tough street in an American city, you just got to ask for MLK.
Councilman C.T. Martin has spent his entire time on council making public safety a priority and making sure those in Southwest Atlanta are not overlooked.
And so you need to give him another round of applause, please.
Additional meetings will be scheduled in the fall for the central and northern sections of the city. Councilwoman Natalyn Archibong hosted a Street Smarts seminar. The course is offered by the National Crime Prevention Task Force, which is an independent team of law enforcement professionals from various agencies from around the Southeast. All of the highly trained instructors are crime prevention specialists who constantly research and evaluate current crime trends.
Ultimately, it all falls back to the same situation. For number one, we need more eyes and ears out there to see what's going on, to hear what's going on, and then to turn around and call that information in to police so that we better know how to respond and deal with those issues.
The free one-hour seminar is designed to educate people about crime prevention and personal safety. Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport is number one in passenger traffic, but is also number one in something else: firearms confiscated by the TSA. General Manager Lewis Miller is asking passengers to be mindful when traveling with guns. Last year, 100 loaded firearms were found during security screenings. The airport has no problem with passengers flying with guns, just as long as it's done properly.
The public also needs to know that you can travel with a gun. You can travel with a weapon. You can, as long as you put it in your checked baggage, and you disclose to the airline that it is in your baggage, it's okay.
According to federal guidelines, travelers should also make sure the guns are not loaded. Miller says most travelers forget they have guns in their carry-on bags, but Chief Turner says that lapse of memory can cause disruptions in officers' duties at the airport.
Anytime that there's a response to the TSA checkpoint here, we take two officers out of service to respond to that, and it takes us between an hour and an hour and a half to process that individual. And so what it does is limits our resources that we have here at the airport to do those various other assignments that they are assigned to do.
Passengers can be charged with a crime and be subject to penalties worth $7,500 or more if they fail to heed the law. So far this year, 67 guns have been confiscated at the airport. Residents joined Councilman Ivory Lee Young Jr. for his quarterly town hall meeting, where constituents received progress reports on current plans and initiatives under consideration. The group also talked about ways to improve delivery of services, and they discussed how to enhance the quality of life in District 3 communities. The open forum gave constituents a chance to speak with top city personnel about a number of concerns.
Our constituents really depend on these town hall meetings to get their issues and concerns addressed so that city services, as it relates to them at their address and at their street, can be perfected.
The town hall meeting was an opportunity to bring city departments to the community in an effort to share information about important city issues. Downtown residents met with a few council members bright and early on a Saturday morning for coffee and informal conversation. During the meeting, residents updated council members on enforcement of the recently passed no solicitation ordinance and discussed plans for the new multimodal passenger terminal in the area known as the Gulch.
There is no agenda. The agenda is whatever the neighbors make it become during the day, or if the council people have anything to say, just an opportunity to talk about some of those hot button issues.
The meeting was organized by the Atlanta Downtown Neighborhood Association, which represents residents in the Fairleigh Poplar District, the South Central Business District, and Centennial Olympic Park. City Council President Caesar Mitchell welcomed the Teamsters National Black Caucus to Atlanta for the 38th Annual Educational Conference. This is an organization of African American men and women who are united by their concerns for the rights and conditions of workers.
I'm glad to be here today to welcome them to Atlanta, certainly to encourage them to continue to do the work that they do in support of working people, in support of jobs, and certainly in support of families in our city, our state, and of course our country.
The Teamsters unite people of goodwill by promoting cultural, civic, legislative, educational, charitable, and social activities that further the interests of minorities. Age is not a factor for some members of Atlanta Fire Rescue. City Talk's Troy Danicus introduces us to two men who made career changes in the middle of their lives and decided to dedicate themselves to helping the community.
Anytime, wherever I'd be, you know, I'd be flying on a plane, coming back from a trip, you know, I'd see a fire truck, I'd see an engine, I'd see guys going out there helping, you know, doing something in the community. And I was like, you know, I'm missing something here.
For Scott Michael, being a firefighter is the culmination of a lifelong dream, as well as a tribute to his brother, who he lost in 2001.
As a child, I always wanted to be a fireman. You know, when we were playing, he would play army man, and then when it was my turn, we would play fireman.
At the age of 44, Scott wasn't your average recruit. Many of his classmates were significantly younger than him and in better shape. However, that didn't keep the recruits from accepting him as one of their own. Scott credits the unity that's ever present among public safety professionals.
I caught a lot of flack in the beginning for not being in the best shape, but instead of letting me trail off and kind of fall behind at the back of the pack, you know, they took it as an opportunity to help pick me up. There was a bunch of guys there that, you know, stuck it out with me and helped me get in better shape, push me harder to make sure that, you know, we leave no man behind sort of thing.
Fellow Station 3 firefighter Jim Dwyer was himself one of the oldest recruits to ever graduate from Atlanta's Fire Academy. A former soldier and stock trader, Dwyer says he was inspired to follow his dream after watching the events of 9/11 unfold.
I started a whole new life at 46, and here I am 55. I want to do 10 more years. I want to be able to say I did 20 if I'm physically capable. So that's why we work out, so I can do it.
Both Scott and Jim know that staying in shape is key to their success in Atlanta Fire Rescue. And to stay in shape, they have an exercise regimen that would make even an Atlanta Falcon blush.
How many push-ups you can do in 5 minutes, which makes it brutal towards the end.
Their self-imposed routine has them pulling up tires over a railing, taking turns flipping over a tractor tire, running back and forth with a fire hose on their shoulders, even a little game of catch with a standard size tire. They say the grueling exercises not only keep them in shape and on par with younger firefighters, it's good practice for those moments when they'll need that strength and determination the most.
5 minutes from now, we could be out on a big fire or a car wreck, CPR. So you just never know what you're going to get here, and that makes it sort of exciting.
Excitement and passion for the job is all the motivation these guys need to get up in the morning and go to work.
In my past life, no matter how good I was doing at a job, I always found it difficult to wake up in the morning. Every time the bell goes off, I'm excited because I'm going to get a chance to do what I probably was born to do.
And for two middle-aged guys who decided to make a second career out of saving people, they couldn't be happier.
But my wife is great. I love her. If this ever gets put anywhere, make sure that you mention, don't cut this part out. My wife's awesome. And it actually helps marriages. You're gone every third day. Wife gets a break from you. So it's really, to me, it's got a lot of benefits to it, this job.
Absence makes the heart grow.
Ta-da!
For City Talk, I'm Troy Danicus.
Both Scott and Jim are grateful for their careers as firemen, and they thank the city for not letting age get in the way of hiring them. A group of firefighters in another part of town are also doing their part to stay healthy and in shape. Firefighters at Station 23C at the airport have daily exercise sessions. Each shift begins the day with some light stretching. And for those who want to take it further, a crew member leads an hour-long insanity workout.
Once we got everybody involved, you know, it's been like a snowball effect. It's just been rolling downhill ever since. So everybody, I mean, I can't say everybody looks forward to it, but once we do it, you know, everybody's happy about it once we've, you know, finished the set.
Guilford says the morning routines not only help condition the firefighters for their daily duties, but it also builds camaraderie between crew members, young and old. Firefighters at Station 15 are getting a helping hand from the community. Midtown Restaurants, Public Draft House, and Bar Unda held fundraisers for the station in honor of its upcoming 100th anniversary. It's also a thank you from one of the restaurant's owners. A Station 15 crew pulled her out of a malfunctioning elevator in the early morning hours. Crew members say they have big plans for the money.
Items we need, cabinets, we need new lockers for our gear, our actual personal protective equipment. Some of those lockers are almost 60 years old. We're also planning on building a small museum for the community in the front of the station.
What our guys have decided to do is that if we could just get a little bit of help with materials, then we will provide all the labor to do a lot of the fix-up work at the station.
Public Draft House and Bar Unda will feature drink specials until September 15th. With all proceeds going to the guys at Station 15. Invest Atlanta highlights entrepreneurs and their startups with a new blog called Startup Stories. The site highlights success stories from small business owners as well as offer perspective from local leaders. The blog will also feature up-and-coming entrepreneurs. Atlanta has been voted number one for minority and women entrepreneurship, number two for entrepreneurial activity, and number five in small business friendliness. We all have obstacles that keep us from choosing a better air lifestyle. Things like traffic congestion and poor air quality can potentially pose threats to our way of life. But there are solutions. Mayor Reed launched the Clean Commute Challenge. The goal? To increase the number of City of Atlanta employees who clean commute by 25%.
A clean commuter is anyone who chooses to ditch their car. So anyone who's willing to leave that at home, take a carpool, take transit, bike or walk to work, vanpooling even counts as a clean commute.
John Zimmerman, Clayton Sanders, and Jamila Mandingall are city employees who are doing their part in reducing the carbon footprint.
My habit is to ride Marta. Try to ride Marta every chance I get. And 99.75% of the time, commute to and from work, it's on Marta. I get to keep my car clean because I don't have to drive in the inclement weather. Mud gets splashed on it. Jokingly, yeah, really. Then, of course, yes. Keep the air clean, air pollution.
I think it's trying to reduce the impact you have. I mean, I get good exercise here, which I think exercise is key to a healthy life, as well as, you know, helping the environment and economical as well. I mean, I'm not doing any gas money as we speak. And maybe if I'm keeping healthy, I'm also reducing my healthcare costs in the future.
I live right up the street, maybe four and a half blocks. So I walk in the morning. Actually, I walk my children to school right down Memorial, and then I walk here, and then I just walk home. My standard rule is if it's less than a mile or a mile, we need to walk or ride our bikes there or use public transportation. I am doing my part.
The city is a partner with the Clean Air Campaign, so go to logyourcommute.org to learn more about how you can take part in the mayor's challenge. Buckhead is getting greener. Home to some of the city's hottest shopping and upscale office space, Buckhead is now officially part of the Better Buildings Challenge. The 41 Buckhead buildings represent a 50% increase in participation in the sustainability program.
This is where the world is going. And cities that are more sustainable and cities that understand this issue are going to be the cities in the world that attract investment from all across the globe.
Some of the sites now part of the Better Buildings Challenge: Lenox Square Mall, the Monarch Tower, and the Atlanta Financial Center. Atlantans commemorate the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. And we'll tell you about the Citizen Review Board, an office that investigates complaints about police and corrections officers. Stay with us. Lee Reed, Executive Director of the Atlanta Citizen Review Board, is with us today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
The Citizen Review Board is an independent agency that investigates complaints against police officers and corrections officers. How are those investigations conducted?
Typically, under our ordinance, when a citizen files a complaint against an Atlanta police or corrections officer, the complaint will go through a preliminary review, looking for the jurisdictional requirements. Once the jurisdictional requirements have been met, then the investigator will interview all witnesses, citizens, and officers or corrections officers involved in the complaint. They'll gather any additional evidence, which would include reports, videos, any recordings, or other documents associated with the allegations. At that point, the investigator will write an investigative summary or investigative report that will be reviewed by me, and then it will be submitted to the ACRB board.
What is considered misconduct by an officer?
Under the ACRB ordinance, we can accept complaints in false arrest, false imprisonment, abusive language, harassment, and excessive force.
How does one file a complaint?
Well, complaint can be filed in our office. It can be filed on the telephone, email, online, or by regular mail.
The board was established in 2007. Give us an idea of how many complaints you receive in terms of numbers, and what that number, has that number decreased since the board was established 6 years ago?
Okay. Well, looking at the data from 2011 to 2012, we know that the complaints decreased from 82 to 67. However, from January to June 2013, we've already received 55 complaints. Now, that is really associated with the community outreach that we've been doing. We've been trying to increase our visibility and accessibility to the citizens of Atlanta. I will say that over the past 3 years, excessive force allegations have had a steady decrease.
Is there anything we should know specifically if we have a complaint?
Yes. You should know that the complaint needs to be filed within 180 days from the date of the incident. It would need to involve an Atlanta police officer or an Atlanta corrections officer, and it would need to be in one of the categories of false arrest, false imprisonment, abusive language, harassment, or excessive force.
If someone has a complaint, how can they contact the Atlanta Citizen Review Board?
They can contact us in several ways. One is by email at acrb@atlantaga.gov. We're always taking walk-ins, and that would be at City Hall Tower, 68 Mitchell Street, Suite 9100. They can mail us at Atlanta Citizen Review Board, 55 Trinity Avenue Southwest, Atlanta, GA 30303. And they can contact us on the web at www.acrbgov.org and by telephone 404-865-8622.
All right, Lee Reed, thank you so much.
Thank you.
11 years and still going strong. We go to Grant Park for the Summer Shade Festival. And a home buyer's workshop in Council District 4 takes home buyers step by step through the purchasing process. Back in a moment. The March on Washington was 50 years ago. It was August 28, 1963, when Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his I Have a Dream speech to over 250,000 civil rights supporters from the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. Councilman Kwanzaa Hall presented a proclamation recognizing the March on Washington's 50th anniversary.
And whereas the March on Washington was a watershed moment in the history of the civil rights movement, setting the stage for the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965.
And here at home, Atlanta, the birthplace of Dr. King, was the location of the Global Freedom Expo, which commemorated the 50th anniversary of the march by creating a special celebration of the historic milestone right here in King's hometown. The expo offered a unique opportunity to honor Dr. King's dream for our country.
We know now that we have to be vigilant. We can't sit on the accomplishments of other leaders and dreamers. So today is the beginning of our time. The question is, what are we going to do? Are we going to work hard as Dr. Martin Luther King and the cadre of leaders that he led so ably? Or are we going to sit on our laurels and just give it away?
Walmart in the historic Westside Village is showcasing photographs that document Dr. King's leadership to secure equal rights for minorities during the 1960s. The photos are from the William Bryan Wilson collection. Wilson was a photographer for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. His pictures have won several national awards. The photos are on display for the next few months. President Mitchell honored gospel great Dottie Peoples for 30 remarkable years in the gospel music industry. The multi-talented singer is a three-time Grammy Award nominee and multiple Stellar and Dove Award winner. She has opened for huge entertainers like the Rolling Stones and Stevie Wonder. Over the course of her career, she has delivered messages of strength, perseverance, and faith through her music. She is a member of the Gospel Music Hall of Fame. Dante's Down the Hatch was a Buckhead landmark for 43 years. The legendary and iconic restaurant known for good times closed its doors back in July. Councilman Michael Bunn paid tribute to the owner, Dante Stevenson, for his years of providing quality food and entertainment to patrons. Last year, Stevenson was inducted into the Atlanta Hospitality Hall of Fame for his creation of such a unique and beloved Atlanta hotspot. Councilwoman Cleta Winslow sponsored a free home buyers workshop to walk buyers through the purchasing process. Buyers learned about down payment assistance, credit readiness, budgeting, out-of-pocket expenses, home inspections, the mortgage application process, and what to expect at closing. Did you know Norman Rockwell did ads for Coca-Cola? We'll show you some of his work. And helping teenage girls understand the importance of fitness and nutrition. That's next. The 25th Annual National Black Arts Festival continues its celebration throughout the city, and award-winning photographer Sue Ross has assembled an impressive collection of images that highlight some of the festival's most amazing moments from the past quarter century.
This is really one of my favorite photographs. It's a photograph by Jim Alexander of the great Alvin Ailey and two of our young people at the in the hall at the Atlanta Civic Center. This is from the very first National Black Arts Festival in 1988, and he also did some interaction with the young people in our community, hopefully who are dancers today. This exhibit is called Sankofa Redux, 25 years of the National Black Arts Festival, and it's an exhibit celebrating our 25th anniversary. We have works by five photographers, all of whom have shot for the festival at different points in time. Myself, Jim Alexander, Gudrun Stone, Brian Christian, and Shannon McCollum. Some of the things that were the most fun to me were when we had the parades down Peachtree or down Auburn Avenue, or when we would have the cultural celebrations in Piedmont Park and later in Centennial Olympic Park. Those are some of the things that come to mind. There used to be a late night jam session at the host hotel, and all of the musicians and performers who were here would get together, and one person would be kind of like the host. Sometimes it might be Roy Hargrove, might be Wynton Marsalis, might be Avery Brooks, but they would bring everybody together and, you know, everybody'd show up. We've got about 40, 45 images in the exhibit. We want you to relive your experience and bring up those beautiful memories you have of things that have happened in the festival gone past. For young people, we want you to come and look at the breadth of Black culture. We want you to look at the range of musicians we have, from jazz to hip hop to blues. We want to look at all the kinds of performance art that are represented here, and for you just to enjoy and to think about what you can create in the future.
The exhibit is on display at the Bank of America Gallery in Midtown. For more information, log on to nbaf.org. When it comes to Americana, two icons arguably always top the list: Coca-Cola and artist Norman Rockwell. Now samples of one can be seen alongside work from the other. The World of Coke is currently featuring American originals, Norman Rockwell and Coca-Cola. In 1928, Coke commissioned the famous artist to create six images that would be used in its marketing campaigns. Of those six, three are currently in the company's possession. The other three, however, are missing.
And the reason that the other three are missing, and they are missing, and if you have it, call me. I would love to acquire it from you, is because illustrations at that time weren't considered artwork. They weren't considered worthy of putting in museums. They were just illustrations. So a lot of times the calendar company would toss it, or it would get discarded in some way, shape, or form.
The exhibit is currently on display in the Pop Culture Gallery until May 2014. And the summer can't slip by us without the Coca-Cola Family Field Day. President Mitchell was at the World of Coke, where this event included music and family-friendly games. There was also a health and wellness expo, and of course, participants enjoyed a variety of ice-cold Coca-Cola products. The Field Day is part of Coke's Get the Ball Rolling initiative, which aims to inspire at least 3 million Americans to rediscover the joy of being active during the summer. Grady Stadium was the site of Day of Play, a joint effort between Atlanta Public Schools and a number of local organizations to encourage and educate young girls to be active and healthy. About 450 teenagers from 13 middle schools learned about nutrition and the benefits of physical activity. Councilman H. Lamar Willis says students saw firsthand the enjoyment of exercise.
Because here's what happens when you exercise, and it happened for me. I tell people the greatest things that came from me exercising was not me losing 122 pounds. It was the clarity of mind and spirit that came from exercising. I actually thought better, I actually was able to work harder, and I actually fundamentally liked who I was better.
There were various activity stations that the girls rotated through, such as tennis, soccer, and flag football. Organizers of the 11th annual Grant Park Summer Shave Festival wanted you to come out and have some fun. Event planners say it was a positive, family-oriented event. The festival kicked off with the Adams Realtors 5K Run, allowing runners and walkers to enjoy the beautiful historic neighborhood on foot.
This raises money for the Conservancy, which is charged with maintaining historic Grant Park and keeping it beautiful for the people. I think it provides a great outlet for families to come out and have fun.
There was also a kids' zone sponsored by Councilmember Carla Smith. The festival also included live outdoor music. Mayor Reed joined Fire Chief Kelvin Cochran to unveil $10 million in new fire service equipment. The media got the first look at 9 new fire engines, 3 ladder trucks, and 3 command vehicles. Cochran says the department has come a long way since its budget was slashed during the Franklin administration due to a weak economy.
Staffing is at an all-time high. As the mayor said, attrition is at an all-time low. We are no longer experiencing brownouts and blackouts of fire stations.
A rapid deployment craft and an inflatable rescue craft were also purchased for the Special Operations Unit. Thank you for watching City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel.